Good morning. I'm saying that really loud because I know there's a whole bunch of people out there in the lobby that are making their way in here still. Our timer has gone, so we're ready to stop our fellowship, which is sad. Sad, right? Now we get to come and fellowship with the Lord. It's not sad. Not at all. All right, I'm going to have us stand, those of us that are here, ready to begin. It is a beautiful day to be in the house of the Lord. The snow is falling yet again, and our eyes are drooping, perhaps. Anybody feeling like they need a little bit of extra hour of sleep or something like that? Yeah, maybe. So, you know, we'll have to just give ourselves a little boost of energy. All right, I'm going to read to us from one of my favorite psalms. I think Psalm 121 is one of my favorites simply because it was my grandmother's favorite. I'm sure all of you can relate to that, that maybe you had someone in your family who had a favorite scripture and it becomes yours. So Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. What a blessing is the Lord who keeps us. There are many things that require us to lift our eyes to the hills. So this morning I'm going to invite you to have a private time of prayer here. I'll close us in prayer, but let's set our heart right to lift our eyes to the Lord this morning, that we would worship him regardless of our tired state. Let's pray. Oh, Father God, the lifter of my head. Today we come to your presence with thanksgiving that you do not slumber, you do not sleep, you see everything, every detail of our lives. And today we offer our hearts and our minds and our hands and our souls, all of us, and we ask, Father, that you would find our worship acceptable to you. For we love you. We thank you for all you've done for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. Bless sing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted on high, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth. Sing us to the Ancient of Days, for none can compare to your matchless worth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. O Ancient of Days.
There is good news for the captive, good news for the shamed. There is good news for the one who walked away. There is good news for the doubter, for the one religion failed. For the good Lord has come to seek and save. He's our rescuer. He's our rescuer. Sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. He is beauty for the blind man, riches for the poor. He is friendship for the one the world ignores. He is pasture for the weary, rest for those who strive. Oh, the good Lord is the way, the truth, the life. Yes, the good Lord is the way, the truth, the life. He's our rescuer. He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore.
Forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound.
have you grab the hymnal in front of you. And we'll do a responsive reading this morning if you would turn to the back. We're looking for number 651, 651. He is our rescuer, and he rescues us that we might share that good news with others and disciple them. We are all discipled. All of us will never arrive till we get there. So discipleship is what we're reading today. 651. I will read the light print, and you can read the bold print. A student is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yet even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another.
This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples.
Thank you. Let us sing of what we believe.
Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender, suffered and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life, forever seated high. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe. Jesus Christ is Lord. life eternal. I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see.
Have the ushers come forward. We'll have a prayer time here. You can look at the back of your bulletins for this week's prayer items, but they're just a portion of those that we could be praying for. So hopefully we're all using this as a guide throughout the week. We do want to add today the Pereira family, who are suffering the loss of their son Austin. So Yeah, if we can remember that family that's saying goodbye to a son and brother, and we don't know the circumstances of this sudden passing, late 20s, so please be in prayer for that. Scripture of came to mind today as I was listening to Trevor in Sunday school was from Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. You guys probably all know this one. Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. It always gets me, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. Yeah, I want to find that joy. Hey, wouldn't that be wonderful? But he sets the example for us. So would you bow with me as we pray for some of the items in our family? Lord God, we pray for the prayer family today, for Miguel, who is well known to us, for the family that is known to us as well. We pray, Lord, that your hand of love would just surround them, that, Lord, they would feel your presence, your peace. In a time, Lord, where peace could be, well, I'm sure it's very hard to find. Why, Lord? So we ask your blessing on them, that you would be near to them, that you would allow us to minister to them and for them. Restore them, Lord, to their life where they serve you. Yeah. Lord, we just commit them to you. We pray for Sarah Gibbard as she is recovering from her medical procedure. We pray for her mom, Jean, Lee's mom, Jean. She has found they've found some spots on her lungs. May she, Lord, as well look to you in this time of uncertainty, of challenge. Pray for Roger as he recovers from his stroke. Brother Roger is from our Forestburg campus. Lord, we just pray that he would feel your presence and that you would touch his body and restore the feeling that he partially has lost in his side. We pray for our missionaries, Lord, Michael and Eva in the Philippines. We pray for Michael, Lord, as he has to take on this project management of this new facility that they're building, a birthing clinic, Lord. We just thank you so much that you're working in that country, in that city, that you're using Michael and Eva. May you just bring them together in this time. May you clear the way that the construction will go really well. And Lord, that you would be known to the people of the Philippines. We pray for our church, Lord, for the many ministries going, for all the volunteers that so diligently put their time towards your kingdom. May, Lord Jesus, they really feel your joy upon them. May they hear the words, well done. And for this tithe that we're about to take, may you use it to expand your kingdom in this town, in Forestburg, in Flagstaff County, and around the world. So, Lord, we thank you for your goodness to us, and we ask that you would be well pleased in all that we say and do. In your name we pray. Amen.
Welcomes me, the kindness of mercy that bought with blood wholeheartedly my soul undeserving
God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. Behold the cross, age to age, and hour by hour, the dead are raised, the sinner saved, the work of your power, 'cause God, you're so good. You're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
Now comes my favorite part of the song. Do we believe it? Go ahead, Darius, put the words up there. Or do we believe the lie?
I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole, I am saved. In Jesus' name, highly favored, anointed, I'm filled with your power for the glory of Jesus' name.
Let's sing it.
I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole, I am saved. In Jesus' name, highly favored, anointed, and filled with your power for the glory of Jesus' name. And should this life bring suffering, Lord, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
One more time, but just you. Here we go.
God.
God is good. What's the saying? God is good all the time. God is good. Do we believe that? Miguel called me on Friday morning to tell me about the death of his brother. And in that conversation, he's like a son to us. Miguel says, God is still good. God is good, still good, church. Despite when the world falls apart from us, around us. When I came in, Steve was praying, God is so good. Roger was in our midst in Forestburg this morning. Can't stand very straight, but he was there to praise glory to God. I got a text from Stephanie on top of dealing with the death of their son. The cold that's been working through a number of our families, they're working through them now. So pray for the Piera family that this cold will not detract from their time of mourning and celebrating their son's life, Austin. few announcements. Baptism class next Sunday after the service here. If you're interested in baptism and haven't ever thought about baptism, you're welcome to come. I just need you to sign up so I know how much to prepare. Food-wise and booklets and things like that. A couple Sundays from now, our district minister, Dennis Gully, will be here. And following the service that Sunday will be a potluck for the church family. The Pastor Ben and Pastor Doug's prayer tour will be commencing. It'll be in Forsberg on March 26th, later date in Killam as well. April 2nd, membership classes. And I was supposed to follow Darius on the slides, and it took me to the last slide to remember that. Sorry, son. And finally, if you're interested in membership, Sunday, April 2nd, is membership classes. And baby child dedication, please talk to me. It's been about like a year since we've dedicated any children or babies, and you've had a few. So if you're interested in that, please talk with me. And finally, if you haven't had your picture taken, you need to get it done today. And I had a few people come up to me and says, well, I don't need to have my picture taken. Yes, you do. Not because we're trying to make you not modest. It's because we want to connect your name so people know who we are as a family of God. But also, more importantly, this photo directory we're going to have is going to be a prayer guide. So we can pray for one another and remember who we're praying for by remembering their face. If you like me, I don't remember names. I remember faces. So I need a face to put a name to. Names, I'll just get lost. Okay? I ask my kids. I barely remember their names. Okay? And I also just like to publicly acknowledge that Jason's team beat my Oilers last night. I've mocked him enough about his Maple Leafs, so humble pie is good. Would you join me in prayer, please? God of glory, God of grace, it is only by the invitation of your Son, our blessed Redeemer, that we approach the place of mercy. Therefore, we come boldly unto the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace in time of need. Lord, you know how needy we are. Before others, we mask our needs. We say, all is well, even sing, all is well, and continue our outward appearance with the hope that our facade will not portray the real situation of our hearts. Lord God, forgive us for such deception. Forgive us for not being authentic among the brethren. We confess our stubborn insistence on running our own lives, telling ourselves that we are really pretty good and that we are quite successful. But then, Lord God, the light of your holy word shines in our hearts and we see the reality of our condition. May we be like Isaiah, cry out, I am a man of unclean lips. May we pray like David, my sin is ever before me. May we realize, as Simon Peter said, I am a sinful man. And like Saul of Tarsus, we would confess that we are the chief of sinners. But Lord God, as we do these things, let us understand, as with these men, that we found that sin was abounding in, grace abounded even more. That's why we come to you. That's why we can come to you, Father, this hour, any hour, because of your boundless grace. Grace that meets our every need. Grace that is more than sufficient for our broken relationships, for our broken hearts, for the broken promises we have given and we have received. Lord God, may we forgive. May we be strengthened. May we be stable as your people because of your grace. And Father, for your grace, we thank you. Fulfill in our lives today what the Apostle Paul then prayed for the Thessalonians. May our Lord Jesus Christ and God our Father, who loved us and in his special favor gave us everlasting comfort and good hope, comfort our hearts and give us strength in every good thing we do and say. We can only do these things because, Father, again, of the grace you've given us. Because of Jesus we pray. Amen. invite the children and the teachers to be dismissed for KBC. Who's ever heard of the Evangelical Fellowship of Canada? A few, good. Awesome. So today we have a speaker, Neil Siemens, and no, he's not related to our former associate pastor. At least not immediately. Neil was born in near a small town in Langdon, Saskatchewan, I think near Carrie Kieber's hometown, and I think Pastor Alec was born in Paraguay, and then he lived in BC, so somewhere along the line they are probably related, but not that closely. But Neil comes from the background of Sears Canada, where he took his family to 3 different provinces, 9 to 10 different cities. They don't remember some of them, I don't think. He's been married to his beautiful wife, Juliana, for over 60 years. 60, yeah. He has served on the board of, or 5 elders boards of 3 different, or 5 different churches in 3 different denominations. And as my wife and I talked with him last night, and also today in Forsberg, we were like, we know a lot of the same people. We just don't think ever met officially. But some of the names he drops, I say, I know him. And then we found out that he was in Regina just before my wife and I went to school there and things like that. It's a small world. He's long maintained an interest in the ministry of the Evangelical Fellowship of Canada. So with that being said, brother, would you come present what's on your heart this morning?
I apologize for being late. Your pastor was talking about pictures. Everybody needs pictures and will have the face and so on. Well, one time when I was introduced to a person, he said, well, I never forget a face, but in your case, I'll try and make an exception. Anyhow, thank you for the opportunity to be here. We missed your music, but we did get some music over at Forsberg, so thank you. As Pastor said, I don't know how much you know about the Evangelical Fellowship of Canada, but I'm going to try and fill in some of the blanks for you. The Evangelical Fellowship of Canada was formally launched 50 years ago, or more than 50 years ago, in 1964. We are an umbrella organization that works with evangelical Christian organizations across Canada, seeking to speak with a united voice to media and government. Now, since any organization needs guidelines or principles in terms of how they will function, the early leaders developed a statement of faith. And everybody that associates with us upholds this common statement of faith. You can find our statement of faith on our website. Affiliates include 44 denominations, 36 higher education institutions, 70 plus ministry organizations, and just a few more than 570 individual churches as well. We have 3 centers for ministry. We have a Center for Faith and Life. It's in Ottawa, strategically located near Parliament Hill. And our experienced and respected staff there build and identify and maintain strategic relationships with our members of Parliament, members of the Senate, and other government officials. Then we also have a Center for Ministry Partnership and Innovation. This is our newest center, and it's in Scarborough, Ontario. Now, in here, we seek to encourage collaboration between individuals, churches, and denominations that work in similar areas of ministry. And then we also have a Center for Research, Church, and Faith. Now, and persons that are specifically trained and dedicated for doing research. And I often say that The reality is that your pastor simply doesn't have the time and or resources to do in-depth research, but we have folks that are dedicated specifically for that purpose. And right now they're working on a project to understand the changing context in church and society, and it's called Family Faith Formation. And what we're seeking to do here is to understand better the parent and church roles in the discipleship of our children. Another research project has just recently been completed. It's called Significant Church, Understanding the Value of Small Evangelical Churches in Canada. And it's a collaborative research project with 13 other Canadian organizations, and it was led by our research team. This study digs into the realities of these churches and examines their needs and strengths from the perspective of their pastors. This is actually available as a free download on our website, theefc.ca/significantchurch. Our mission statement is uniting evangelicals to bless Canada in the name of Jesus. We're pro-life. We believe all life is sacred from conception to natural death. Now, we have numerous current initiatives that we're involved in, and I'm going to elaborate a little bit on them. One of them is prostitution. A year ago, the House of Commons Justice Committee was reviewing our current legislation. The bill is called Protection of Communities and Exploited Persons Act. I don't know if you'd remember, but it's not that long ago when prostitution in Canada was illegal, and the courts struck down that provision, and so our federal government of the day had to come up with legislation to regulate, and this is the legislation that has. And so while prostitution is now legal in Canada, there are still many activities associated with prostitution that are illegal. And as an organization, we believe that the current legislation should be maintained. There's pressure to completely just do away with any legislation on prostitution, to just legalize it. But we're concerned about that. We believe that prostitution preys on vulnerabilities. Trafficking increases with decriminalization. There's violence and stigma that are inherent in prostitution. And so not only is the current legislation constitutional, we believe it is safer. Now, there are organizations that seek to be involved in this, and there's one organization that I'm aware of, Next Step Ministries Project Safe Home. The reality is that probably most of the young ladies that are involved in prostitution are not there by choice. They've been trafficked. They have somebody who's pulling the strings, whatever. They're forced into prostitution. So this organization seeks to rescue them off of the streets. They're placed in a safe home where they can live for up to a year at no cost, have an opportunity to get their lives back together. Many of them come to know the Lord through this ministry. And then there's pornography. Research suggests that 90% of boys and 60% of girls will be exposed to pornography before their 18th birthday. The average age of exposure is between 11 and 13 years of age, and it's getting younger. There are more than 4 million porn sites on the internet. And sadly, 1 in 4, 25% of all searches on the internet are for porn. And sadly, also during COVID, the numbers increased dramatically worldwide. So that's a really sad circumstance as well. Aside from addiction, there are other health issues. And so EFC continues to work with our governments, especially our federal government in this case, in urging and encouraging our health minister to actually do some in-depth research on the health risks and the health issues associated with pornography. The reality is that our kids often just fall into pornography accidentally. The internet is used, it's the modern day encyclopedia. Our children use it for studying, for research, whatever, and often accidentally porn pops up. So currently there is a private member's bill before the Senate, Bill S-210, I believe it is. In any event, if this legislation should pass, then the pornography producers would be forced to set up their sites in such a way that you wouldn't accidentally have it pop up, that you would actually deliberately have to search for it. So that would be definitely an encouraging part of that, if that were to happen. And then there's human trafficking. Globally, human trafficking generates around $150 billion annually. It's exceeded in revenue only by the illicit drug trade and illicit arms trafficking. And 95% of trafficked victims are women and girls, and 43% of those are between the age of 18 and 34. Statistics or research suggests that 24.9 million folks worldwide are engaged or are entrapped in modern-day slavery. 16 million, 64%, are exploited for labor. 4.8 million, 19%, are sexually exploited. 4.1 million, 17%, for state-imposed labor. So this is a serious issue in our society, and it happens everywhere. And then there's the issue of charitable status of pro-life groups. Our Prime Minister recently asked our Finance Minister to introduce amendments to the Income Tax Act to make anti-abortion organizations, which in their opinion provide dishonest counseling to pregnant women about their rights, ineligible as a charitable or charitable organization, or revoke their charitable status. We are concerned because this could target areas like crisis pregnancy centers and others, and it would become kind of a values test again. You probably remember a number of years ago on the Student Summer Jobs Grants program where you had to have your values test, and the objective basically is to agree with our federal government exactly where they're at on these issues. So those are all significant issues. Another really significant issue and very current is MAID, medical assistance in dying, euthanasia assisted suicide. It was legalized in Canada in July of 2016. And as you can see from the graph, it's just grown tremendously over the years. 139% increase, 157, 127, so on. And to the end of 2021, there have been 31,664 persons that have been euthanized in Canada. Now, we don't have statistics yet for 2022, but based on the incremental growth and based on the numbers we had in 2021, it's probably not unreasonable to assume that we would have reached more than 40,000 folks that have been euthanized in Canada. A sad commentary on our society for sure. And now they tell us that the majority of MAID deaths are older folks, 56 years of age and older. However, there's significant pressure in our society, on our government, to include mature minors. I don't know how you define a mature minor, but what a sad state of affairs, in fact, that it really is. And from a country that didn't have euthanasia that long ago, we are at the point now where we're leading the world in harvesting organs from MAID deaths. It used to be, not when it was originally established or legislation was passed, that you had to have a grievous irremediable condition in which your death was reasonably foreseeable. So that was one of the safeguards on it. But in 2019, the Superior Court in Quebec struck down that provision, ruling that it was unconstitutional. We, EFC, encouraged the federal government to appeal that decision to the Supreme Court of Canada. They didn't. As a result, they've had to comply with the court order, and so that is no longer an issue in terms of qualifying for euthanasia. And so many of the safeguards have been lost that we had. And in fact, as of this March of this year, mental illness alone was supposed to be a qualification for euthanasia. Now, the federal government got a lot of pushback on that, including from the Psychiatric Association of Canada, and so they have postponed it for 1 year. We would like to see it just disappear completely. But it's just a sad situation where it's at in Canada. Now, the rallying cry for the proponents of MAID is death with dignity. We agree with that, except we believe it should be achieved and can be achieved through palliative care, hospice care, home care. Rather, with the advances we have in medical science and in medical practice, terminally ill folks can be kept comfortable to the end of their natural life. And so that's what we would encourage, and to have more palliative spaces. That is another issue. We just don't have enough of them in Canada for the need. And so, again, we're working with federal government, provincial governments, encouraging them to provide more palliative cases or care places, and to recognize that there's a spiritual dimension to palliative care, not just the physical dimension. And so that's a significant issue as well. Then there's another significant issue for us, and that is abortion. Prior to 1969, all abortions were illegal in Canada. But in 1969, the federal government made an amendment to the criminal code that would allow abortions in the case where a mom's health or life were in danger. You had to be approved by a panel of three medical practitioners. It had to be performed in a hospital. But the reality is that the proponents were opposed to that legislation from the start, the pro-life persons, and many of our, or I shouldn't say many, but some of our medical practitioners flaunted the law and just basically ignored it. And so eventually the question came before the Supreme Court of Canada. And so in 1988, the Supreme Court struck down that law. They concluded it couldn't be applied equally and fairly across Canada, so they struck it down. Now, when the courts strike down a law, they usually give the government 1 year to come up with legislation to regulate it after that. And so that was the case here too, although it was such a thorny issue even at that point already that it took almost 2 years. And so in 1990, the federal government, in a free vote in Parliament, passed legislation to regulate abortion. But before any legislation passed in Parliament can become law, it must also be passed through the Senate. Sadly, in January of 1991, it was defeated in the Senate, and the government of the day never pursued it any further beyond that, and no government since then has ever made any effort on any legislation. The bottom line is that Canada is one of the only developed nations in the world with no regulations, no restrictions on the procedure. While most medical practitioners would probably never perform an abortion in the third trimester, legally speaking, a mom in Canada can abort her a child right up until the moment before that child is born. The unborn have no rights in Canada at all. And according to Stats Canada, we have between 100,000 and 108,000 abortions performed annually. Now, along with this, along with the medical assistance in dying and abortion, we also are encouraging governments, federal and provincial, to provide conscience protection for our medical practitioners. Manitoba is the only province at the present time that actually has legislation. And so we continue to work with other provinces, with the federal government, to encourage them to provide. In Ontario, for example, the Medical Association requires their members to give referrals. They don't have to participate, but they're expected to give referrals, which is, it's very much against their strongly held beliefs. I mean, if you don't want to perform the procedure, you don't want to recommend it to somebody else. It's kind of like driving the getaway car for the bank robber. But anyways, those are some of the really significant issues. And then another current issue is religious freedom for military chaplains. An advisory panel has recommended that chaplains from certain faith groups should be excluded from being military chaplains. Now, there are many chaplains serving from Catholic, Evangelical, Orthodox, Jewish, and Muslim faith groups. In fact, the majority of serving chaplains are from faith groups that the report deems unacceptable. So again, you can go to our website and you can find more detail on this information as well. And then just about a year ago, a little over a year ago, in December of 2021, rather, the legislation, Bill C-4, banning conversion therapy, was passed through Parliament. Now, we believe that no one should ever be forced into therapy against their will, but we feel that this legislation is so broad that it's restricting people and restricting impact of freedom of religion and expression. But anyways, again, you can find more information on our website, and especially for pastors and counselors, it's important for you to be aware of all of the details as well. Now, the Evangelical Fellowship of Canada seeks to engage on all of these issues, and there are several ways we do that. One of them is through intervener status in court cases. We have intervened before the Supreme Court of Canada on 32 times and 34 more times in lower courts on various religious freedom issues. Another way we are involved is presenting submissions and briefs to the government. This is where our Center for Faith and Life in Ottawa is so important to us, getting to know the members of Parliament, the members of Senate, government officials, and seek to have influence and impact toward righteous legislation. Also, whenever the government is looking to pass some new legislation, usually the legislation is introduced in Parliament, and then after second reading, it is sent to an all-party committee for further study. And EFC has been invited many times to make presentations before the committee. And so we have an opportunity to seek to influence toward righteous legislation there as well. So that's still fairly brief overview, a little more detail so you have some information. But that's basically what the key issues that we are involved in every day. And we have a resource table out there, and we have a lot of resources. We would ask you stop by, help yourself to the resources. And if you're interested in getting regular updates, we also have a little brochure, a little pamphlet, or a little sheet of paper, I guess it is, where you can give us your email address, and then you can get weekly updates on this as well. And EFC is a charitable organization, and we would also encourage you, if you're so led. I know there are many wonderful charitable organizations, and you can't begin to support all of them, but if you're so led, we would encourage you to consider to become supporters of our organization. So that's a brief overview of that. For the remaining time, I would like to just share with you some thoughts about the Bible and sanctity of life, about the Bible and our relationship with our Heavenly Father. And I want to consider four questions in that regard. One of them questions, what do we mean with the term sanctity of life? And then, what does the Bible say about sanctity of life? And why does it matter what the Bible says? And what then, how should we respond? Now, a generic meaning with the sanctity of life is the state of proper functioning. To sanctify someone is to set that person apart for the use intended by the designer. In faith and ethics, sanctity of life is a principle of implied protection of life which are said to be holy, sacred, or otherwise of such value that they are not to be violated. So that's a definition of the term. What does the Bible say about sanctity of life? Now, I'm going to be referencing various scriptures as we proceed, but as a backdrop, I would like to read the first 18 verses of Psalm chapter 139. O Lord, you have searched me and have known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You understand my thoughts from afar. You scrutinize my path and my lying down, and you are intimately acquainted with all my ways. Even before there is a word on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all. You have enclosed me behind and before, and have placed your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is too high. I cannot reach it. Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the dawn, if I dwell in the remotest part of the sea, from there your hand will lead me, and your right hand will take hold of me. If I say, surely the darkness will cover me, and the night will be only light around me, even the darkness is not dark to you and conceals nothing from you. But the night shines as bright as the day. Darkness and light are alike to you. For you form my innermost parts. You knit me in my mother's womb. I will give thanks and praise to you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being formed in secret, and intricately and skillfully formed in the depths of the earth. Your eyes have seen my unformed body, and in your book are written all the days that were appointed for me, when as yet there was not one of them. How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God! How vast is the sum of them! If I could count them, they would outnumber the sand. When I awake, I am still with you. It's always so astounding to me to think that my Heavenly Father saw my unformed body long before I was born, and all the days that were assigned to me were written in His book before one of them came to be. But this passage just shows clearly just how special our relationship with our Heavenly Father is. And some other examples are all we want to just go back a little bit to the creation. Genesis chapter 1. Chapter 1, verses 26 and 27, the Bible says, Then God said, Let us make human beings in our image to be like us. They will reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, the livestock, all the wild animals on the earth, and the small animals that scurry along the ground. These verses state that humanity was created in the image and likeness of God. And Adam and Eve were put in charge. They were to look after the garden. They were to look after all of the animals. And then a few verses later, in verses 29 and 30, God explains the options for food. He said, Look, I have given you every seed-bearing plant throughout the earth and all the fruit trees for your food. And I have given every green plant as food for all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, and the small animals that scurry along the ground, everything that has life. We are apparently were vegetarian originally. And then in chapter 2 and verse 7, the Bible tells us that Adam was created from the dust of the ground, and God breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and he became a living being. And then a few verses later, chapter 19, we also read that all of the animals, all of create, were created from the dust of the ground, and they were brought to Adam to name them. And so, and if you continue reading in chapter 2, we find instructions concerning the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And also in chapter 3, we read about how God visited Adam and Eve for fellowship in the cool of the day. Every evening he came to visit them. And in Isaiah chapter 49, verses 15 and 16, talks about the fact of the possibility of a mom forgetting her children. I can't imagine it, but the Bible talks about it, that it is possible for a mom. But our Heavenly Father will never forget us. In fact, Isaiah tells us that He has our names inscribed on the palms of His hand. And so, and then the question asks, like, these are just evidences of how important and how the Lord desires to have a relationship with each of us. But you wonder why. Like, why does the Lord have a relationship? Because in Acts chapter 17, we read that God, who made the world and everything in it, since He is Lord of heaven and earth, He doesn't live in man-made temples and human hands, can't serve His needs, for He has no needs. He Himself gives life and breath to everything, and He satisfies every need. So God is completely self-sufficient, and yet for some reason, He desires to have a relationship with you and with me. But it seems to me that the ultimate example of our special relationship with God is the plan of salvation. You see, when Adam and Eve messed up, God wasn't shocked. He wasn't surprised, because the Apostle Peter tells us in his first epistle, chapter 1 and verse 20, that the plan of salvation was devised in eternity past. The plan of salvation is not plan B. God knew that we would mess up. But He desires to have a relationship with us to be reciprocal. He wants a relationship with you and me, because we also choose to have a relationship with Him. He could have created us all as robots, so we would have no option but to follow Him. But He wants us to choose to follow Him. He longs to have a relationship. And He said, Bible says, you're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But it is because He wants us to, not because we don't have an option. And so as we reference these, it's apparent to me that God has a special relationship with us. So then the next question is, why does it matter what the Bible said? Well, first of all, the Bible claims internally to be inspired. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, we read that all Scripture is inspired by God, and it is useful to teach us what is true, and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong, teaches us to do what is right. And God uses it to prepare and equip His people to do every good work. It's our instruction. It's a roadmap. It's conviction to correct us from error and to restore obedience. And it's training so that we can live to please God in everything we do. Now, I believe the Christian faith is absolutely reasonable, rational, and logical, because in Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 18, the Bible calls us to reason. Let us reason together, says the Lord. And also in Romans 12 and verse 2, we are called to renew our mind. So it has to be part of our being, but we need to also recognize that it's rational. Now, this is internal evidence that the Bible is divinely inspired. So the next question then might be, is there other evidence, external evidence, to support the historical evidence of the Bible, the inspiration of the Bible? I want to just share with you, as we consider that question, a little bit of my own faith journey. I came to know the Lord shortly before my 13th birthday. 4 years later, I was baptized. Then after high school, I went off to Bible school, where we studied the Bible, we studied church history, and so on. And we also had to do a lot of memorization, scripture memorization. I think I memorized something like 300 verses, and many of them are still in my mind, not necessarily the reference. But anyway, I had some excellent input into my life. And then later on, after we were married, as Pastor mentioned, I had a career with Sears, which took us to 3 provinces and to 9 or 10 cities. Now, whenever we were transferred, the first thing we did was to find a place to live, a home. And the second thing we did was to find a church where we could have fellowship, where we could worship. And so because of our moves, we had the privilege of having many wonderful godly pastors had input into our lives with their teaching, with their mentoring. Nevertheless, while I never ever considered abandoning my faith, I did have some questions, these what-if questions. What if the Bible is not true? What if the Bible is not historically accurate, divinely inspired? Or what if Jesus is not who he claims to be? Now, I never considered to abandon my faith, as I said, but I needed to answer these questions, and so I did a lot of reading, and several authors that I read were C.S. Lewis, Lee Strobel, Josh McDowell. They had a significant impact on my life. C.S. Lewis grew up in a Christian home, lost his mom through cancer when, at age 10, he became very bitter against God for taking his mom. By the time he graduated from Oxford University, he had become an avowed atheist. He subsequently taught at Magdalene College, an affiliate of Oxford. Providentially, he had some Christian colleagues there, and so they challenged him to re-examine his atheism, which he did, and he went on a search. And the more he researched, the more he hunted, he discovered and he realized that the Bible is true, that the Christian faith is valid. He eventually became a Christian and called himself the Reluctant Believer. You can read his story in his book, slips of mind now, Evidence That Demands a Verdict. Anyhow, he was an amazing apologist for the Christian faith. He's passed away a number of years ago, but his legacy is still there. Then there was Lee Strobel, also a devout atheist and an avowed atheist, his wife an agnostic. He studied journalism in the University of Missouri, studied some law at Yale, became an award-winning legal journalist for the Chicago Tribune. Again, providentially, they had a Christian neighbor, a lady that lived next door. This lady became friends with Leslie, shared the Lord with Leslie. One day when Lee came home from work, she announced to him that she had become a Christian. And he thought, wow, that was not part of the deal. And he thought for sure his marriage was done. But he decided to bide his time. And so he watched his wife, and he was just amazed and intrigued by the positive changes he saw in her. And so his wife and her new friend would attend church regularly. He would never interfere with them going, but he didn't go. But sometime down the road, one day as his wife was getting ready for church, she invited him to join. And he thought, yeah, I will. He thought he'd go there, you know, he could just be a critic, hear with what the speaker had to say. Well, it turned out he was so intrigued by what the speaker said that it set him on an extended journey. I believe it was about 3 years. And he did a lot of research from a medical perspective and all sorts of reasons, ways about Jesus, whether this was legit, whether it was valid, whether he ever lived, whether he died, whether he rose again. And so he did this research, and you can find his story in his book, The Case for Christ. It's easy reading, and I would encourage you to do that. I know for me it really helped solidify my faith in one of my questions. What if Jesus isn't who he claims to be? It just confirmed it. And again, he's our contemporary. He's an amazing apologist even still today. But then there's also Josh McDowell, and he's one of the writers, the readers, or the books that I really clicked with. It's heavy-duty reading. It's the book is Evidence That Demands a Verdict, and or his updated version, New Evidence That Demands a Verdict. After high school, he went off to college. His plan was to study law. His goal was to become a governor of Michigan. Now, he said, although he had this persona of being this happy-go-lucky guy in the college, he was actually quite miserable. And he realized, or he discovered, that he wasn't alone. There were quite a few. But there was this one group of students, 8 students, 2 profs. They were always joyful. They were lived above their circumstances. They knew what they believed. They were willing to stand up for what they believed, and he liked them, and he liked to hang out with them. And then he found out that they studied the Bible, and he thought, oh my goodness, you poor folks. Like, how can you be so deluded? Anyhow, he would engage them in conversation. He said there was one young lady that engaged him frequently, and they would have their discussions. And so one day she kind of threw down a gauntlet for him. She said, look, if you don't believe the Bible is true, prove it. And so he decided to take up the challenge. And in his mind, he felt, give me 2 weeks, three at the most, and I'll have it resolved. Well, he discovered very quickly it wasn't going to be quite that easy. In fact, he left school for a while, traveled to Europe, to universities, to libraries, to do his research. One day he was in the library working on his research, and he got into a conversation with a librarian, and she wondered what he was up to. And he just matter-of-fact said, well, I know the Bible isn't true. I'm here to prove it. And she thought, oh, I have a friend that I would like to introduce you to. She had this lawyer friend, a devout follower of Jesus. So she introduced Josh to this gentleman, and so they had their meetings, conversations, and so this gentleman was curious what Josh was up to, and again he said, just matter of fact, I know the Bible isn't true, I'm here to prove it. And so his new friend challenged him. He said, well, did you not study history in school? And he said, oh, yes, I did. And he said, well, how do you know it's true? Well, he had never thought of that, but being pragmatic, he decided, well, I guess I'm going to check it out. And he found that historians, in some cases, with as few as 6 original manuscripts, accept history to be legitimate, to be valid. Original manuscripts, he found, is one of the key ways of authenticating history. He found, in his research, the most he ever found was 90. In fact, he discovered that the story of Alexander the Great, the first writings didn't show up until some 400 years after Alexander lived, yet based on contemporary events, based on archaeology, other issues, historians are convinced that his exploits are legit, they're valid, they're true. So then he decided he would apply the same test to the Bible. Well, much to his surprise and chagrin, he discovered there are over 34,000 original manuscripts for the Bible dating back thousands of years. There are more than 5,000 for the New Testament alone. And many of these date back to within 100 years of the events they talk about. So at this point, he concluded, if I'm going to be intellectually honest, if I'm willing to accept any history as being historically accurate, I have to accept the Bible. Because when the same tests are applied, the Bible is so far ahead, there's no close second. But just because the Bible then has proven to be historically accurate does not prove divine inspiration. And so his research continued, and he discovered, among other things, that there are many prophecies that were made in the Old Testament that were fulfilled 200, 300, many years later. And so there's a lot of evidence for the inspiration of the Bible. Now, for me, the thing that really sealed the deal is the story of Jesus. There are 350 prophecies in the Bible that were written some 600 and 800 years before Jesus came that totally explain his life, where he would be born, who his mother would be, that she would be a virgin, where he would live, how he would die. Crucifixion wasn't on the radar. Yet these gentlemen from many years back, 600-800 years earlier, predicted that Jesus would be hung on a tree. He would be crucified. And so Jesus fulfilled every one of these prophecies right down to the tiniest detail. I mean, the probability or possibility of this happening by chance, by the law of probabilities, is so remote as to be impossible. In fact, somebody did some research and he discovered that for even 9 of these prophecies to be fulfilled by chance would be equivalent of burying Texas 2 feet deep in toonies, put a little red dot on one of the toonies, and ask a blind person to find it. And so it just sealed the deal for me. I mean, that's it. I Jesus is who he claims to be. The Bible is historically accurate, is divinely inspired. And so when Jesus said in John 14:6 that I am the way, I am truth, I am life, I was prepared at this point to just place my confidence, eternal destiny, on the basis of what the Bible says. So that's the story of the Bible. I think it's relatively important, especially in our day and age. Even in some of our churches, we're finding that we're getting questioning, like, I like this part of the Bible, but I don't really care for this part of the Bible, and we like to pick and choose. But I believe that's not our option. The Bible is the totally historically accurate. It is divinely inspired. We have two options. We accept it for what it claims to be, or we just absolutely out of hand reject it. So that's important. And I think it's especially important in our society. Just all the stuff that's going on in our society, just the things that I've talked about with it, where EFC is involved in. The reality is that we need to be grounded. First of all, we need to be confident that the Bible is true. We need to know what the Bible says about issues in our society. We may not be able to use the Bible to have a discussion, a dialogue with a neighbor about some of these issues, but we need to be grounded, firmly grounded, confident that this is what the Bible teaches. We are confident it's true, and we're content with it. And so that's why I just feel it's so important to be aware of the special relationship we have with the Lord, the authenticity of the Bible. And so then the last question we want to just talk about briefly is, what then? How should we respond? We have several options, I believe. We can accommodate, which basically means we throw up our hands, join the gang. We can isolate, completely withdraw. But if we do either one of those options, how can we have an impact in the world to share the love of Jesus, to encourage and be a witness for the Lord? I believe there is a third option, and I believe Jesus exemplified that option, and that option is to engage. He ate with the downtrodden. He ate with prostitutes. He ate with tax collectors, publicans, sinners. I always find it curious how tax collectors are synonymous with sinners in the Bible so often. But anyway, that those are the people. And he said, it's the sick that need a physician, not the healthy. The self-righteous Pharisees who were religious leaders were there. They didn't think they needed the Lord. But he went to the ones that knew that they needed to. And so, again, we're called to be salt and light. In Matthew chapter 5, the Bible says that we are to be salt to preserve and flavor, light to illuminate. And also, again, the Apostle Peter in his first epistle in chapter 3 and verse 15, he encourages us to be ready to give an answer for the reason, for the hope that we have, and that we should do it in a gentle and respectful manner. So again, I just thank you for the opportunity to share with you this morning. I trust that what we have shared will be an encouragement to you, perhaps a challenge. And so I would just like to ask us if we could pray together. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your goodness, for your kindness, for your love. I thank you for your unconditional love, your constant love, your unending love. The Bible says that you loved me, you loved us long before we even had any inclination toward you. And I thank you for that. And I find it so intriguing that you saw our unformed bodies long before we were born, and all the days that have been assigned to us were written in your book long before one of them came to be. I just thank you for your love. You loved us so much that you sent your one and only Son, Jesus, into the world, that if we would believe in him, we would never perish, but would have eternal life. You sent the Holy Spirit to indwell us, to encourage us, to strengthen us, to teach us, and I thank you for that. I just thank you for your goodness, for your kindness, for your love. Jesus came, lived the perfect life that we couldn't live, took the punishment that we deserve when he died on the cross to pay the penalty for all of our sins, past sins, present sins, future sins, All of them were placed on his shoulders. And in place of our sins, he has clothed us in his righteousness, which meets God's standard of perfection. And so, positionally, we are justified, just as if we had never sinned. It's such an amazing relationship we have with you. I thank you that you love us. I thank you that you care for us. I thank you that we have eternal security, that we know when our time on this planet is over, we will simply transition into your presence forever. What a tremendous gift. What a tremendous blessing. And I thank you for that. And as we go through the coming week, I pray that we would be salt to preserve and flavor, light to illuminate, to share the love of Jesus wherever we go. And we ask this all in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.
Neil, for coming to share this Evangelical Fellowship of Canada. I invite you guys, after the service is done, take a look at all the information he has. You're around to ask questions or answer questions. And thank you, Evangelical Fellowship of Canada, that they're keeping a Christian voice into our culture in Canada. Could you imagine if this break wasn't in place? I remember 30 years ago, almost in Bible school, Brian Stiller was first executive director. He would come to our Bible school chapel, and he was a very intense young man at that time, and he saw what was coming. And so thank you again. Invite the worship team up to conclude our service today with a song.
Won't you stand? As we head into our week, may we be blessed. We have all that matters. In the morning, when I rise, in the morning, when I rise, in the morning, when I give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. Just give me Jesus. When I
to die. Oh, when I come to die, give me Jesus. Give me
why we want Jesus is all things are possible. As you go into your week, now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Let us go.